Welcome back to Kaplan's residency series. I am again Dr. Frank Nono. I am an assistant professor of medicine at the Icahn School of Mount Sinai. And I am here to interview or to speak to Dr. Conrad Fischer. We're going to get some application advice from Dr. Conrad Fischer. Hello, Dr. Fischer. How are you?
Outstanding.
Great. So please introduce yourself.
So I'm Conrad Fischer. Hi, everybody. And I am a residency program director at Brookdale University Medical Center, which is in New York City in Brooklyn. I've been a residency program director at several other places in New York City before. I'm also responsible for the physiology course at Touro College of Medicine, which is in New York City, where I'm associate professor of medicine, associate professor of physiology, and associate professor of pharmacology. And I've been teaching Kaplan for the last 15 years, and here we're here to talk about how to get a residency in the United States.
Excellent. So I'm going to ask you a series of questions that we would get from medical students, and I'd like to get your advice on how you would answer them.
Sure.
So let's get started. So first question, how should I choose a medicine specialty?
You should ask yourself, if you didn't have to work for a living, what would you choose to do? If you did something because you just wanted to get up and do it, then you'll know it's the right thing to do. If you choose based on length of training, if you choose based on the hours, if you choose based on what sort of money you think you'll get, if you choose based on something about the duration of training, it's the wrong decision.
So it's in your heart?
I think so.
What do you love?
I think so. I think it should be that. It should be, you can have all the reasons in the world. You know, I once asked my father why he married my mother, because my mother is a very religious, devotional, emotional person, and my father is a super hyper-intellectual, difficult guy. And he goes, well, you know, kid, you can have all the reasons in the world, but, you know, I just liked her company. She smelled right. You know, so at the end of the day, it comes down to that. Does it smell right for you? But I really think that it comes down to this.
What's
to choose.
Feeling?
When I was finishing medical school, I chose a one-year preliminary medicine position because at the time I thought I was going to go be an actor, and I chose a residency to be in mid-Manhattan simply because it was near the theaters and where the acting classes were, because I'm like, oh, I can't sign up for 3 or 5 years. It's too long. And I ended up finishing as a PGY-7.
Wow.
So I ended up doing 7 years.
Because you loved it.
That seemed the right thing to do at the time.
Great.
So I was going to do 1 year of something and then just go out and practice. But, you know, so at the end of the day, you look back and you say, well, you're going to be living with this for a long time. What really matters is whether you liked doing it. Also, the other thing is that you can't really get doctors out of the hospital. Once we get in, people can complain and carry on, talk about the difficulties of A, B, and C. But, you know, we all work with a lot of guys who are up in their late 60s and 70s and sometimes 80s. You can't pull them out of there with an oil can of ice grip. You can't yank them out.
Nope.
Sometimes
they die in the hospital.
Oh, my goodness. You have to, like, hook them up to the back of a pickup truck and yank them out of the hospital.
They're demented and they're
right.
They're in crutches and they're still walking around doing
it. Right. So it's the same thing. Dr. Noto and I don't work in the same hospital. And I've actually never asked him about this point. But you see how he relates the same thing.
Absolutely.
Okay, so no matter what anybody says, people vote with their feet. People must deeply love what they're doing, or they wouldn't stick in it for so long, have to be dragged out.
And I've had people do medicine residencies and then decide they didn't like it and go do something else like anesthesia, and they're just so happy because it didn't feel right, and then they just said, I have to do something else. They went to another specialty, and they more training, but they're happy because they just didn't feel like it was in their hearts.
I think that's perfect. It's like that, because the thing is that what's the worst that happened? It doesn't work out. That's how I'm able to always get remarried. Why?
Exactly.
What's the worst that happened? It doesn't work out. Change later,
just
you know?
Just get a prenup and you're good.
Oh, yeah. So
you can always change, but yeah, that's a great point. One of my residents asked me yesterday, do you like being a hospitalist, or should I do that or do a fellowship? So I said, if you did a fellowship, what would you do? And she stopped. I says, you're thinking too much. Don't do a fellowship.
Right.
You should say, bam, cardiology. Well, okay, then do cardiology. It has to be in your heart. You have to breathe it, live it, eat it, sleep it, or don't do it.
I think a lot of people get caught into something where they think that they're, I mean, I didn't know. I just didn't know for a very, very long time. You made it up. I must tell you that I actually find people who are medical students, who as second and third year medical students go, I want to do this specialty. I always have a tremendous suspicion about those persons.
Too early.
Your father told you that? Your mother told you that? How'd you know to do that? Yeah, you don't know. How do you know? You know, you're an undifferentiated stem cell. Choose a colony before you blast off.
I could agree more.
Yeah, something weird about it. Like to get these people to go like this. From the time my mother was 8 centimeters and dilated and my head passed the pubic symphysis, I knew I wanted to go into dermatology. As soon as my head passed the pubic symphysis, on the way out, I went, where? I want to be a dermatologist. Where's the application?
Impossible.
Yeah. Take your time.
We don't believe it.
Take your time.
Excellent. Yeah. Good point. Okay, so picking up with the next question. So here's a question for you. How important is a USMLE in residency application?
Well, if you don't want to get a residency, it's not important at all.
Okay.
So it's kind of like saying how is important it to be good looking if you're trying to get a date, you know? So the answer is, well, I have two things is that, so when I'm on rounds, so I'm on rounds this morning at 8 o'clock in the morning and we're going room to room, we're seeing patients with residents and medical students. And the number of times a day that things that are all from a USMLE step one or two or three course, that is the things that we're seeing in the hospital. And I think that if people, like for instance, there's a patient with chemotherapy, neutropenia, and had a fever, neutropenia. And the person, the intern, could not remember what the cutoff was for neutropenia, couldn't remember what the right antibiotics were. And you'd think, well, you know what? This is straight out of a step one and two course, straight out of a step two and three course. And I always wish that we could go back in time and say to people, if you really knew the depth of what you are supposed to learn and how you're going to need it later on, you would have made all the time in the world and all the intensity of the world to study. So when you're talking to people about how do people die of a GI bleed, when you're talking to people about what's octreotide, what's a TIPS procedure, mm-hmm. when you're talking to people about, hi, why is it better to have, you know, I mean, we saw a patient yesterday morning that they had a person with diabetes and hypertension not on an ACE inhibitor. And you go, wow, you know, if this was a step two question, mm-hmm. if this was a step two question, that would come as an excessively easy question.
You'd get the answer.
And so I think if you start from the fear-based approach that goes, if I don't have USMLE, I'm not going to get enough interviews. That's true. If I don't have above a 230, for instance, at my place, if you don't have above a 230, you have very small chance of getting an interview. We could have a requirement for above 240, but we want some people with some personality characteristics.
Right.
Because how do you have a way of knowing who people are? How can you look into people's soul across the internet? We get 3,000 applications. Your program gets 3,000 or 4,000 applications.
Exactly.
My program gets 3,000 or 4,000 exactly. applications. How are we supposed to look into people's soul? Is it the personal statement? They all sound the same. Letters
identical.
Of recommendation all say somebody sounds great.
Identical. It's the same letter over and over
again. The same letter over and over again. Everybody wears either blue or black on an interview.
They look the same.
So how are you supposed to know? And that's why USMLE was so valuable. The other thing is this. Kaplan himself, Stanley Kaplan, was a guy who wanted to go to medical school. And he couldn't get in because at the time that he was applying in the 1930s and 40s, there were certain forms of legal discrimination at the time. And he thought standardized testing, what a wonderful idea. Nobody knows my background, my group, my ethnicity, my religion. It's blinded. So it's based only on ability. And that's how he got into standardized test prep himself.
I didn't know that. That's interesting.
Yeah. Brooklyn.
That's great.
Brooklyn guy. Mm-hmm. So the answers for the USMLE are two things. One, you need to get it to get a residency because other than that, how am I as a program director supposed to know?
But it goes beyond that.
But beyond that, it's medical
to the bedside.
Knowledge.
Goes to the bedside, yeah.
Goes to the bedside. If people could really appreciate how important the things that we were learning, then you inhabit again, like from love. I mean, who doesn't have time for what they love? Even if it's 3 o'clock in the morning, the baby's crying, you get up because you love them. Or somebody knocks on the door and they go, hi, I love you. Okay. Because you have time for what you love.
Absolutely. And how are you going to know what to give those patients if you don't take the exam and study for the exam and prepare for the exam?
I think that people make a big dissociation between, oh, here's my test score, but I'm really much better than that. I'm really great.
No. No.
No. No. No. No.
Excellent point.
No.
Very good point. Next question. So I think you kind of answered this already. What is a competitive USMLE score?
Well, if you actually can search on the internet and see what the average scores are for people who go into specialties, so you can see the average of a person who's going into internal medicine is about 235, 232. Right. You can see the average of a person going into otolaryngology or orthopedics or ophthalmology is about 242, 245. Mm-hmm. You can see the average of people going into psychiatry is about 225, 230.
Right.
So you can actually see them as published figures. I think that the higher the score is, the more you have options about what to do. It's where you want to live and the number of interviews you get.
Right. Okay. Yeah, there's a broad range, I guess, depending on specialty, subspecialty, right?
Yes.
Okay, how hard is it to get a high score on USMLE?
It depends who's asking. I think it's like this. It's an equation. Your ability times your effort is your result. Your IQ times your effort equals the result. If you're really, really smart, you don't have to make as much an effort. If you're moderately smart, then you got to make twice as much effort. It's kind of like, you go, listen, I'm not very good looking. How do I find myself the right wife? And I go, make twice as much money.
Excellent correlation. Excellent.
I think that, look, nothing in this life or the next was made without effort.
Right.
That's the meaning of the word to strive for something. Striving. Which is that, you know, it is the literal meaning. It has another word in other languages to make striving for something. But what is your striving? Now, I don't mean fighting. It's the difference between kital, fighting, another word for striving,
right?
Which you know, which is to say you're striving for this, and the more you're striving, then it will result. I just think that people have to know that there no effort is wasted.
So it's different for everybody, but some may have to put more effort than others.
I think that there's nothing that is achieved without hard work in this lifetime.
But everybody has to put effort in.
And, you know, there's my idea. I think that people don't realize how much. I think if you get on the third to fifth time, I think a genius does well on the third or fifth time through. I've been teaching physiology. This is my 30th year of teaching physiology. It's the first thing I ever did. Why am I still reviewing physiology? And I've been doing it for 30 years.
Never ends.
Oh, my God. I feel like they're shroud of time. They're going to use carbon dating on me. Cut me in half and count the number of rings.
You always have to continue to learn, right? That's an important point.
If people want to get a good look, you're getting a ticket into what is the highest paid profession in the United States of America with the greatest opportunity and the greatest physician shortage in the history of the country. And if you do not want to work hard to get it, then you don't deserve to get it. Period.
I agree.
So what's the good news? Land of opportunity, but opportunity doesn't mean given. It means you can do it, you can make it, and you better work hard. You better bust your hump to get there.
I agree. Excellent point. Okay, here's a good point. Which USMLE step would be considered the most important for residency applications?
Only step 1, 2, and 3.
Okay.
That's it. Step 1, 2, and 3.
That's it.
I think that it's, I couldn't choose one or the other. I think
they're
that,
all important, yeah.
I think that it's better to have at least one excellent one than maybe two mediocre ones, because then you could say somebody can ascend. Is a one-hit wonder in music better than a no-hit person? I think so.
So, great point. What if somebody got a 220, for example, or 225 in step one, and then they get a 250 on step two?
I think it shows an awful lot that I'd rather have somebody that can hit the mountaintop once.
Okay, so that's a...
Also, I believe in redemption. What about people who actually failed before? I go, if you pass, you better pass big.
Gotcha.
You better pass big.
You can't just squeak by. You
can't
have to
just squeak
blow
by.
It out of the water.
You can go by and say, well, you know, I failed the first time.
I had a headache that day.
But on the second time, I got a 250. I was abducted by aliens. I had explosive diarrhea. It wasn't my fault.
Then
actually,
you can
let me
get
make
away
that as a point about things. You know what the thing that is so disturbing about people is that when people don't do well, instead of saying, because how do you address an interview if you don't do well in one? You just say like this, you're absolutely right. I wish I'd done better. I'm disappointed too.
Address it,
and you say, I'm disappointed too. Don't make excuse about it. You know, and what do I hear instead?
My dog died that day.
I have test-taking anxiety. It's like 94% of people have test-taking anxiety. And here are very legitimate. My mother died. My father died. My wife left me. My husband left me. I found out. I took a couple of residents from Syria, because they managed to proceed and develop even despite obstacles. The next day, a guy came in and he goes, "Well, I did very badly because there's a conflict in my country. There's a war going on," and I go, "Well, I can certainly understand that, but I got." Two Syrian guys, Pakistan, Nigeria, these other places, Lebanese, Palestinian territories, and you go, they performed. You got to perform.
That does not sound
I'm
like
sorry.
Legitimate
I'm
excuse.
Sorry for the difficulties that you have in your life. I'm sorry. But you have to perform. These other guys did. I said men and women. They did. So you can't make excuses like I had this personal tragedy, you know, or I have this anxiety. Because what it really is saying to people, and the program directors will never tell you this to your face, is they're really saying, I just want you to know that if I have any form of personal emotional difficulty,
I'm going to fold.
I'll say it again.
I'm going to fold.
I just want you to know that I can't perform under personal emotional difficulty. And I can't function. And by the way, if I have a patient that's sick and I screw up the treatment, I'll let them know that my father got leukemia. It's like, well, you have to perform.
Absolutely.
You have to perform.
What's going to happen when you're an intern and the patient crashes in front of you? That's pressure.
Yeah.
You have to deal with that.
You have to deal with it. I don't, for some people that's made sound harsh, but it's just the way it is.
I couldn't agree more.
No.
Couldn't agree more. Thank you. Okay, I think you already answered this, but what about...
Let's expressly address the failure issue.
Yes.
I think that number one thing is, I gave a contract to a guy this year because when he failed once, he passed big. But the other thing about it is he didn't make excuses. He said like this, I know I didn't do well, I was really disappointed. I was shocked when it happened. And I will not let you down. I will not let you down. And I will make it. And I will rise up because I'm not going to embarrass myself or let you down if you take me. And I gave him the contract.
Very good. That's a nice story. Very nice story. Yeah. So it's good to hear that there is hope if you fail, but you just have to do the right thing, right?
Yeah.
And he did very well the second time.
And they did well the second time. But the other point is, it turned out to be a very, very hardworking, decent intern.
That's great to hear.
You know, I'll tell you who did not get something from me. A guy who got modest scores the first time. And then I go, look, you have a 210. But you see, there's a person right down the hall there. I know you come by 10 times. But there's a young lady right there. She had a 235. Do you think that your score and her score are the same? And he goes, yeah, it's all the same. Wow, really? I said, okay, I'll tell you what it is. You've been here 10 times knocking on my door. So I'll tell you what. If you can go walk up to that woman and you go tell her that you deserve the score and not you deserve the position more than her, and you have a 210 and she's got a 235, you tell her you deserve the spot because I'm not going to tell her. If you can do it, I'll give you the spot. You go up and tell her I deserve your spot because you got a score that's 30 points above me and 25 points above me, but you don't deserve it, I do. He goes, I can't do that.
Oh, well.
That's it.
Right. How important is visa status in obtaining a medical residency?
I've been on this subject five times today about the issue of visas with people. As a real New Yorker, my grandfather was deported twice. And every single person, all four of my grandparents, none of them were born in this country. And so I do a bunch of visas. Now, the problem with visas is that sometimes, particularly for one guy, his medical school was bombed, and he could not exactly get the documentation out of the rubble. Wow. And the documentation that he needed. So some people are just not able to show up on time, and that's why some people don't take visas. The United States is a country of immigrants, and the immigration that comes from medicine is the highest level. It's not like the kind of immigration where, absolutely, you know, my grandfather came and he unloaded boxes from ships in New York City Harbor for 30 years.
Right.
So the problem is, though, some people don't want to deal with visas because sometimes people don't show up, or in the case that we have now, a woman started the program and had to convert her visa, and we had to make a very significant changes to be able to accommodate a switch from a J to an H visa, and it was problematic. So I think that that visas can be overcome by having higher scores, because there are certainly a number of people that I took that, because they had visas, had higher scores than others.
Mm-hmm.
And I think also that every program director will say that they would rather have. Now, this is what we talk about when it's not on camera. Every single one of them will say, I would rather have an international graduate with brains and higher scores than a dumb American.
Of course.
Okay, for sure. So that's why we continue to take people with visas, and I will myself. And my own program is going to stay outside the match for this reason next year, because we think that we'll get higher quality people that way.
Okay. Yeah, I know we've had issues in our program, too, with visas. Sometimes they can't show up, or it's difficult. It's very difficult.
Right.
But okay, it's good to know that you take them. When should I submit my application for medical residencies?
I would say at puberty. Don't wait for September 15th when Eros. I would say from the first ovulation, get in first. I actually think that people really are ridiculous in thinking that they have to be there by September 15th. So it is much better if you can squeeze a few more weeks and you have your visa and your application. It'd be better to have a higher score that gets in there in October than it is to be lesser prepared and just to think that the program directors, that if you don't apply by September 15th, that's the opening day. And I think that people understand that most places don't even start their interviews.
We don't start till
November.
We saw in October.
You know, so you can go October, November. Yeah. But the thing is, it's the process is probably 3 months of the year.
Yeah, we're interviewing till February.
You're interviewing till February. So I think that what people think is that the applications open September 15th, and if you don't have your application there by September 16th, you're out of luck. And that's just not the way it is.
Okay.
So I think that study hard.
Okay.
And study up until the last minute.
I couldn't agree more. Use every time. Use all the time you have, right? I agree. Good. Thank you. What additional medical residency application tips can you offer?
I think that people don't realize that you can't change very much. You can't change the name of your medical school. You can't change your transcript. I think that all that people can change, really, the only variable, ends up being their scores. That's the only thing that you can change. Now, a lot of people get very wrapped up in the issue about being expected to have U.S. clinical experience. I really don't think that it's as valuable as people think. And the example of this would be Americans who go to medical school in the Caribbean do 2 full years in the United States. But they only have a match rate that's about 5 percentage points higher than general international graduates. So it does not support saying that U.S. clinical experience is the end all and be all.
Okay.
I think that research doesn't even get looked at until you're chosen in for interview.
Right.
Gets looked at afterwards.
Right.
And then I think that when you show up for interview is to know as much as you can about the training program before you get there.
Okay.
That's what I'd say.
Okay. Great. Thank you. How important is a letter of recommendation from a U.S. physician?
I don't think it's important at all.
Okay.
But this is the realm of things that when you listen to a panel of other residency directors, mm-hmm. I think it's important to get a diversity of opinion on this.
Okay.
Because this is the one where some people will say it matters a lot, and some people will say it doesn't matter very much. I think that the same with the U.S. clinical experience. So, therefore, it's very important to label what is a personal opinion versus everybody agrees that visas make it a little harder. Everybody would agree on the value of USMLE. But on the issue of U.S. physician with residency, I'm equivocal on it. For instance, a letter that basically says, Frank's a really nice guy. Frank's a really smart guy. Frank asks good questions. We really liked him a lot. Is a very not too useful letter, even if it's coming from, you know, the Surgeon General. You know, it's just not that important, not that special. When I had a letter to, that has to say something individual about you. For instance, when I was applying to medical school, my biochemistry professor, who's, I did thyroid research in his lab for a year, and when I finally saw the letter after a while, after I got into medical school, what he wrote about was, there was a big storm. There was a hurricane. The roads were flooded out. There was a dog stranded on a small island in the middle of a lake. I was on my way home from the college, and I saw Conrad Fischer jump into the lake and swim to get the dog and took the dog out of the lake. And he also did biochemistry research, too. So it said something individually. It said something individually. And that's a true story, by the way. But the thing is that it said something individually about you. Generic letters, and unfortunately, this is cultural. Cultural. According to culture, people are getting their letters written from the point of view of their culture, where you're not, don't be too personal. That's not good. You shouldn't be personal. You should only say most professional, neutral things. And you go like, yeah, but that it's a cultural identity. People want to hear something about you individually. So if the U.S. physician letter says, we had a lady who with metastatic cancer and she was very sad, and we thought it was she was sad over her cancer, but John stayed with the patient and found out because it's really that she's depressed because her grandson got kicked out of high school or something. You know, that is individual. That would help you.
Okay. Which is say, yeah, I know that guy's great.
Yeah,
useless.
Well, who's going to write a letter like this? You know, Ali is a moron. Bob is an idiot. Bob can't count from 1 to 10 without passing out. I've never seen this guy. You've seen trisomy? He's got a quadrisomy. I might interview that guy just to see what he's like. All the letters say you're great.
Yeah, I read letters, and it's...
That's the way you do. You're a generic, universally nice guy, right? Everybody's nice.
Yeah.
Same way you write them, right?
It's almost the same
thing. Of course you do.
Yeah.
Everybody's nice.
Yeah, but you have to have that individual story makes a very big difference. So choose your letter writers carefully, right?
Yes, but have them say something individual about you.
All right, good. That's very helpful.
So an individual letter that says something special about you from home is more important than a generic letter just to say you got one from a U.S. guy.
Okay. That's good advice. Thank you. Well, you already answered the U.S. clinical experience. Would you like to comment on this again?
I think that people should get a diversity of opinion from residency directors about the U.S. clinical experience.
So you think it depends on the program and the program director. So for you, it's not so important, but for program director at another place, it might be.
I'm very equivocal about it.
Okay.
In other words, I'm not a big fan of observerships, but other people are. For instance, I've eaten in many restaurants frequently. But you would not want me to cook for you. You can't say, well, listen, I did an observership in residency. Or, listen, I should drive a car. Why? Because I've ridden in the back of taxi cabs. I've done an observership. I did a clinical observership in a taxi cab. Well, let me fly your plane for you. Why? Because I've many times driven in. Sometimes I was even in first class, and I watched the pilot.
I watched the pilot. I could do it now. Yeah. I tend to agree about the observer shifts. I don't think they help the application much at all, and I'm not impressed by
them. Let people get a diversity of opinion. It's an opinion.
Yeah, it's an opinion. That's true. All right, good point. What else can students do? Anything else students can do to improve their chances of getting a residency?
Yeah, you see, this is like when students, you know why I think it's interesting to see how this question comes up again like this? Because this is like students when they come up to you in class, and you answer the question, and they go, yeah, but I mean, besides that USMLE stuff, what else could I do? So the reason this question is in here multiple times is because it's just like students who you go, work hard, sacrifice, get rid of your family. If you have children, sell them. Tell your family you're not available for a couple of months. You'll get back to them. That's what you need to do, because the score is what's going to open it up for you, and we have to stay on that point.
Tell your parents,
because
your wife.
Because I will tell you, it goes like this, is that if you fail, and the people who go, oh, Habibi, how come you don't pay any attention to me? I am so lonely. Oh, you know, how come we don't go out? How come we don't do that? Oh, Habibi, I feel so lonely. You go, if I fail, are you going to accept any responsibility for when I fail? No.
Nope.
Then later on, she's going to go, how come you failed? You're weak. You're weak. But, Habibi, you told me I should go out. We should go here and go see your family. Well, you should have been strong enough to say no.
The family needs to be supportive.
Family needs to be supportive means show up with food and leave me alone the rest of the time. No, I'm telling you, if you're not successful, they're going to lose respect for you. And they're never going to accept responsibility for the fact that they distracted you.
So tell your parents, your husband, your wife, your mistress, your children, everybody.
That's right. Leave me alone. Let them all meet up and go out to dinner together.
Perfect.
Yeah?
I couldn't agree more. It's a big sacrifice, but it's what you want to do. You did it. I did it. Mm-hmm. I missed my cousin's wedding in medical school. We're very close. I didn't go to his wedding.
That's all right. You can kind of show up for the divorce.
Oh, yeah. He already got divorced.
See?
So it didn't really matter. I would have wasted my time
at
anyway.
You see, you didn't miss anything. You would have wasted your afternoon at a wedding that didn't work out anyway.
For no reason. Exactly. Couldn't agree more. Okay. Here's another question. Is it better to apply pre-match or in the match?
Well, the thing is that this is a misunderstanding. The applications all go through the ERA system. So there's no applying in the match and outside the match. But interestingly enough, the reason that this question is in here is because this is very this is misunderstood by people. See, these questions are directly a collection of how, if we had a group of people in a room, this is what they'd be asking. Mm-hmm. Because it's a misunderstood question. See, people always ask this question because they don't understand that the application is one application through EROS. Whether you match, go through the match or outside the match is later on. But the application, there's no such thing as application.
One application.
Outside the match.
Right.
Now, the hard part is that there's no way to know which places are in the match or outside the match. For instance, there's no recording to say my program's outside the match, your program's in, right?
We are in the match, yes.
Right. So, and we're probably the only program with fellowships in New York City that is outside the match, though. Mm-hmm. And for the reasons we said about getting more highly qualified internationals. So getting a spot outside the match is a little bit like an arranged marriage. In an arranged marriage, baratmarriage.com, shadi.com, you don't know who the person is, but you know who the family is. That's the medical school. You get some recommendations, but because they're trying to get a piece of a dowry or something like that, your recommendations are always a little biased, right? And then you meet once or twice, and then you just end up getting engaged. And, you know, how do you get an outside the match position? You try and show you're interested, but not look desperate. You make it clear to people that you like them and you hope they like you, and then follow up. send flowers.
Now, what if you get a pre-match offer, but you still have more interviews?
If you have a pre-match offer and interviews, it's a very difficult position. First of all, there's no way to know that whether or not you're going to the other interviews.
Right.
Second is that the match is set up entirely to protect the applicant. If the applicant puts, it always goes with what their first choice is. So if the hospital puts you first, but the applicant puts you fifth, it goes with the applicant's choice first.
Right, right.
So it becomes morality of, is it moral to go on more dates once you're already engaged? Probably not.
Right.
Now, the morality, another common question is, can I apply to more than one specialty? Absolutely. Can I apply to more than one specialty in the same hospital? Absolutely. And then it's, people don't understand, is that I have no idea who's applying in pediatrics. I would have no way of knowing. They always think we do, like we're all comparing notes. Who applied to you? Who applied to you? It's like walking up to somebody and going,
I have no idea what happens in pediatrics.
You would have no idea. It's like walking up to you and saying, hi, who asked you out this week? Are they the same people that asked me out? It's like you don't compare notes like that.
No.
So you have every right to apply to multiple specialties and in the same hospital. It's not immoral. It's not illegal. You have the right to do that.
Now, what if somebody asked you at an interview? Do you admit that?
Well, the being asked on an interview is the same like dating. If you somebody asked you and you said, Dr. Noto, am I the only person that you're interested here?
Yes,
and
honey.
You go, good, good answer. Your automatic answer is, absolutely. You're the one. And I'm the one you want. And so therefore, the idea is that you gotta give people the feeling. Now, if you don't walk up to people and also go, hi, I'm applying in your program, but I want you to know I also applied in pediatric surgery, psychiatry, and anesthesia. You don't have to tell people that.
Right.
None of their business.
Right.
Now, actually, sometimes people bring up things on interview that they shouldn't be bringing up, like that. You don't have the right to ask things like that. They shouldn't be asking you things like that. They shouldn't be asking you things like, are you married? Do you have children? Do you plan on having children? These are illegal questions. They
what would you
not
recommend someone should do if they are asked that in an interview? Should they
tell
say,
people what they want to hear?
Yeah.
You ask me an illegal question, I don't see I have an obligation to tell you.
I'm never going to have children.
I say, I had my tubes tied on the way into this interview.
Excellent.
Okay.
Now you have the right to lie because it's an illegal question.
Exactly. I had a vasectomy on the way into the interview, but it's reversible. I have it reversed on the day of graduation.
Never lie unless they ask an illegal question.
I am not going to ever say to someone, I will not say the word that people should purposely tell an untruth. I will say that it is not legal nor moral to ask people things like that. It's none of their business.
Okay.
We never ask things like that. We never say things like,
us either.
How many other specialties are you applying in?
Never. No way.
And it's just not right to do that.
Right.
So.
Right. Excellent. I think that's very helpful because I get these questions all the time too. It's very helpful. Thank you. What about soap and not what you take a shower with?
Right. Well, the secondary match, I think that people should understand this. The secondary match will be taken entirely by U.S. students. I think that the likelihood of matching for an international in the soap is at less than 10%. So I think that people should make it, throw all their eggs into the primary match and grab that contract if it's offered to them.
Excellent point.
Grab it with both hands. What's the best medical school to get into? The one that lets you in.
Couldn't agree more. What does your hospital program look for in a residency candidate?
Well, you see, the thing is about, the reason also I want to tell you why in medicine the scores take on such a life of their own is the only thing that scores really predict is more scores. And 1/3 of residency programs in the country are below the minimum 80% pass rate on their internal medicine boards. To maintain accreditation, you have to have an 80% pass rate of your residents. And so consequently, the residency director goes, I might really like this guy, but if they don't have the scores, they're going to go down the toilet in their boards, and I'm going to lose my job as a program director. Now, beyond that, we actually went too high on scores because we started out interviewing above 240. And the people that were coming in, a lot of them were like robots. How are you? My name is 252.
Yes.
And so we backed it off. And then it becomes like anything else, that once you have some basic qualifications, people just want somebody that's got a little personality and a little warmth. It's hard to demonstrate an interview. I feel
that's
really bad
so
for
hard.
People.
I agree.
It's very bad. I mean, what are you supposed to do? I put out a $20 bill. I pretend to leave the room. Then we watch through a two-way mirror to see if he grabs a $20 bill. You know, so...
it's so very hard. I can agree more.
You get screened in by schools, scores, visas. The letters tend to sound the same. The personal statements tend to sound the same. And then, you know, what do you really find in an interview? You know what you find? It's screening for psychosis.
I agree.
What are you really going to find?
Do you have a personality or can you, yeah.
And then you only need 2 minutes anyway.
True. Good point. Very good point. What does your hospital's residency program consider red flags?
Well, people switching schools in the middle, breaks in between, periods of training, things where their basic science grades are much lower than their clinical grades, and I think that those sorts of things about why did you switch schools, why was there a year break here? We don't have a cutoff anymore for how many years since graduation, because we used to. And then I was at was at the Chinese Medical Association, and they, I'm like, clearly these people must be inadequate because they need this push from political pressure from the president of the Chinese Medical Association. So they put a whole bunch of people in front of us to interview, me and the vice chair. And we look at him, we see the guy's got, like, good scores, 235, 240. And we go, how long has it been since you graduated? He goes, 5 years, 6 years. So we said to these people, we go, must be something wrong with this person. So why do you have this big break in between your training? And the guy says like this, I was finishing my PhD at Harvard. You go,
okay.
And the next guy goes, I was finishing my PhD at Johns Hopkins. And we looked at each other and we got rid of the five-year cutoff because we realized that that cutoff was artificially excluding some people who were doing some very legitimate things.
That's a good point.
And that's a true story from this year. The guy's in my training program today.
That's a good point. But you have to make sure that they fill those 5 years with something.
Yeah, not like, you know,
meaningful.
I was running a water park in Orlando.
Oh, that's what I was going to do. All right, forget it.
What were you doing? Gambling in Dubai.
What's wrong with that?
Right, running a shawarma shop. And actually, I used to say that until the guy goes, I was running a shawarma shop. So
okay.
So I'm not necessarily opposed to it. So it should be something legitimate, right?
Okay, excellent. Good point. Oh, here's another one. What about students that take 6 months, or I've seen a year or even more than a year?
I'm not as concerned with that as I am at the grade.
Okay.
Did you get there? Did you achieve it? What'd you get? What'd you get? Show me some brains. Look, it's not a perfect measure, but you know what the idea is? It's the best measure we have.
Okay.
How do you want it to be like this? What about the countries that don't have national certifying exams, and how do you get a residency? Who likes who? Who doesn't like who? That's why I never tell people where my family is from, because then they think that I'm in their group or I'm not in their group. But I'm in everybody's group, and everybody's in my group.
Excellent. So if you saw somebody took a year off, that wouldn't...
I think like this. It's a high-stakes exam. It is a high-stakes exam. You're going to live with the consequences that a long time. How'd you do at the end?
Okay. The end justifies the means?
I think so.
Okay.
And this one it does.
Okay. Good. Excellent point. How about the personal statement? How can I write the best personal statement?
It should be something that is personal to you. See, the problem with the personal statement is that it's the hardest part of the exam, of the application for people, because you really think, and particularly for people like you and me who think we can talk people into anything, right? Oh, if I just talk them fast enough, I'll get anything. So I think it should be something that where you show how you overcame a difficulty. You should say, here's a problem, here's how I addressed that problem. Here's a problem, here's how I addressed that problem. Here's what I did to overcome something. And then at the end of the day, if your scores are good, you'll get what you want anyway. The other thing is I also am a big believer in this. I'm a big believer in, first of all, is that personal statements can hurt you if they're done badly. Mm-hmm. You'd be amazed at the number of people who sending things grammatically incorrect.
Oh, yeah.
And just stupidly written. So you got to get it looked at. And a lot of those people, by the way, that were U.S. grads, who an international guy that got his thing read often did better because he was more careful. More careful. But the other part is, so in my own personal statement, I had... to see a world in a grain of sand and heaven in a wildflower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in 1 hour. And my faculty advisor looks at this and goes, see a world in a grain of sand. William Blake, good. She goes like this, Conrad, aren't you weird enough already? Take this out, would you? So I put, I just want to leave a committed life behind. Martin Luther King said that. So I put that in a personal statement. I want to leave a committed life behind. Says committed. Just play it straight, would you, Conrad? So what I do, I left it in. The only person who commented on my personal statement on interviews was a cardiologist, and she said, oh, my God, this is so beautiful. You know, these personal statements are usually so boring and mediocre. Yours is like poetry in it. That's really nice. That ended up being the place I matched.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so another person's weird was another person's interesting. One person's weird was another person's interesting.
Good point. So you can't give broad advice on this because it depends on who's reading
Some people love Ethiopian food. I can't stand it because you eat with your hands, and I can't get over the fact that you can't sterilize fingernails. But some people love it, right? So some people might love it, another person might hate it, right? Like, for me, if it doesn't have, you know, red meat in it, like, don't give it to me. But I'm vegetarian. Agree. So it's like, I hate to say this because it sounds awfully corny, but be yourself. And if you can't be yourself because you're not very interesting, be someone else who's more interesting. You could be me for a while.
That's a little too interesting.
See?
We'll send that poem out. What should I avoid in my personal statement?
Chlamydia.
Okay.
The biggest thing to avoid is not getting it double checked. Get it double checked. Get it read.
Good point. I remember I had mine read by a friend who was a literature major. He says, look, I'm a medicine guy. I'm a science guy. I says, literature's not my thing. So I had a couple of my friends read it and just went over a few times, and I think that's very important. Should I address USMLE failures in my personal statement?
I think that addressing the failures in the personal statement is important because you're not going to avoid them. In other words, there are certain pimples that people may not notice. You might smell bad, but maybe the interviewer has anosmia. But the failures, you're not going to get around. And I think it's better to address things head on.
Okay. I agree.
Address it head on.
I agree. I think that's important. How do you select candidates to interview for residency?
Most program directors actually are not the ones choosing. Most program directors have a program coordinator or administrator who he says, here, filter this. Get me everybody from these schools. Get me everybody with these scores. And it's sorted by computer. I look at them individually myself, but how do you, even if you spent 2 minutes in application, 2 minutes in application for 3,000 application is 6,000 minutes. 6,000 minutes.
Don't have the time for that.
That's 100 hours. Forget it.
So scores, schools.
That's a lot of people are never not having their application. That's what people don't understand about this. You know, it goes with a computer sort that says, get me everybody with above this score, and that's it.
So a lot of people, the applications aren't even looking
at. Then after that, then you look at things.
Okay. How should I prepare for the interview?
That's a very hard question. There are people who actually have professional interviewing services. I think that this is, again, something to get a diversity of opinion on, because this is extraordinarily subjective. So I would do this by asking a whole bunch of people. I think that You have to, you can't dress in very much dramatically different because people, you never know what people are going to want, so everybody tends to look the same. You have to look friendly, show up early, look enthusiastic, and always have a question for when they say, do you have any questions? But the problem is the range of questions that people can ask are so narrow. You can't really ask things like, so is this program a killer? Like, is the call schedule lousy? And you can't ask program questions like, I mean, even I got offended by one guy. We actually did have a board. I get brought to places that have problems sometimes, like board pass problems. And the guy actually said, so what are you going to be doing to fix the board pass rate around here? And I want to leap across the room and kill him.
He survived?
He did not. I thought it was a sign of poor judgment to ask that and in that way. It's kind of like having someone who comes to see you because you're an orthopedic surgeon and they've got a broken or hurt knee, and you go, like, so when are you going to get over your limp?
Good point.
So the problem is you've got to have some questions that says, hi, what do you like best about your program? What's the most interesting thing here? What are the opportunities for research? Give me what's the structure of the day like? What's the structure of the day like?
Okay.
You know, I know that this seems terribly safe, but it is.
Teaching didactics, conferences, right? Want to know education.
But look, the interview is very anxiety provoking. Yeah. Back when I used to get nervous on interviews, I remember being distinctly very anxious about things like that. I used to prepare a lot, and it made me even more nervous.
Yeah, I agree. It is very anxiety provoking. I agree.
I think a couple of Xanax is probably the best approach to most.
Not
of
too
these
much,
things.
Though. You don't want to walk.
Not too much.
You don't want to walk in there drunk.
But I think two Xanax might be too just
might
right.
That might work. Should I send a thank you note after the interview?
Thank you notes help in a number of places. They think it's a sign of interest.
I like.
So
them.
I think in general people like it because it's you lose nothing by sending it. And handwritten.
Yes, I agree.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's nice. What mistakes should I avoid during an interview?
I think that looking sullen, not smiling, not having anything to ask about. And also, I think it's hard for people with the phrase where they go, tell me about yourself. Even if it's restating your CV, just say, well, you know, I'm A, B, and C. This is where I'm from. This is what I like to do. This is what I'm interested in. Even if it's nothing else except restate your CV.
That's a tough question.
I think that people don't realize that a lot of interviewers have not read the materials before they get in the interview chair.
It's
so it's better that you should state your own CV. On the bright side. It means if you've done something bad in the past, they might miss it.
Good point.
Yeah.
What are the best questions to ask on an interview?
I'll tell you what not to ask. How easy things are.
Yeah.
Call schedules.
Salaries.
Salaries.
What's for lunch?
Now, in my own system, we have... What's for lunch? In my own place, we have everybody interviewed by a resident and attending because we want to give them the private time to ask what's it like in the day-to-day. It's very difficult. You have to pick it up by osmosis. But the thing about the questions for residency are to say, what's the structure of the day? What's the opportunity to learn? How do people flourish here?
I think that's an important one. Opportunities to learn and research and
safe.
Yeah, I think those are great questions. That's what we want to hear. Because we want to hear that you're here to learn, you're interested in learning, not that you want to leave at 4 o'clock every day.
You know, when it becomes anything that looks like it's avoidant of effort, people want to hear that you're devoted.
Exactly.
And you have to communicate that devotion.
Couldn't agree more. What's the most common answer to questions? If I had to start over again to do this, how would I do this differently?
I would get divorced earlier out of my first wife, actually, probably. That's one.
Okay.
Number two, I that's a very interesting thing about that. You're thinking about, I'm not sure that I understand this question, actually.
This is a tough question.
Yeah, what do you think it means? We don't know.
I don't really know what this means.
We don't know. We don't know. We'll pass on this.
We'll pass this one.
That's right.
I think that's the last question, actually.
That's it. You see, and that's the one. You see,
they save the worst for last.
The last question is like tension interviewing. You know what I mean? It's like where you go to somebody and you say, okay, listen, can you open that window? But you've nailed it shut and they really can't open it.
Have you done that? Because that's a good idea. I like that. I'm going to do that on my next interview.
I think that the system, I think, is fair. That's what I want to say the most. I think the system is fair. I think that looking at a combination of where your interview is just one piece of it, where you went to school is one piece of it. If you speak extra languages that are in the geographic area, for instance, in you, where you are working here, if people speak Spanish, it's an up. Where I'm at, if people speak Creole, it's an up. You know, or in other areas, if people speak Russian in Brooklyn, it's an up, it's an added. Mm-hmm. These are all pretty fair. The other thing is that the match, if anybody's ever seen the movie A Beautiful Mind, which incidentally was filmed half at my own seminary, is that the mathematical algorithm that he won, that John Nash won the Nobel Prize for, the first application of it was the match. The match came out of that Nobel Prize winning a mathematical algorithm that's what's it's good for the group and good for the individual. So if you actually look at his life and see that he did that work at the late 40s, early 50s, the match was in about 1952. So the first application was the residency, National Residency Matching Program.
I did not know that.
And so therefore, it's not just what's good for me, and it's definitely not just what's good for the hospital. What's good for the individual and what's good for the group simultaneously. And ultimately, the system is fair.
I agree. And the
problem that some people have with a fair system is that we see when people are being put down in some other place, they go, I wish I had that system was fair. But when people don't take the test seriously, they don't really work as hard as they want, they should have, and then they don't do well, then they go and they say, no, I want you to give me an exemption from the system.
Yeah.
Well, fair system means
it's for everybody.
If you make the grade, you'll make it in. If you don't make the grade, you won't make it in. And that's about as fair as you can make it. Because other than that, let's put it this way. There are four schools in the SUNY system, the New York State system. Which is the best of those four state medical schools in New York? Which is the best of the seven or eight state schools in Texas or Illinois? Would you know? How would anybody know which one's better? Galveston, Texas Tech, Houston, how would you know? How would you know between New York, between Stony Brook or Buffalo? You wouldn't know. Is the transcript the same? Not a different transcript, different grading systems, different difficulty grade levels.
That's true.
So how do you know? And the answer is that you don't. And that's why the unifying thing across the system is USMLE. Now, people will ask the other program directors. You'll get a diversity of opinion. You'll see what you got.
Okay.
All right.
Well, I think this has been very helpful. Thank you very much. It was
You're
a pleasure
welcome,
talking with you.
Okay.
I hope that you found this helpful, and I hope you enjoy the series. And hopefully... you may see Dr. Fischer.
You will see me on interviews, or myself
at our programs.
You will see it, but don't stop 5 minutes too soon. Go all the way. Go to the limits of your humanity, and don't stop 5 minutes too soon.
Best of luck, and have a good night. Take care.